One question that came up just real quick was about concern about placebos, right? You had mentioned you have a placebo arm, and a question from an audience member was, well, I can't miss my drops, so how does it work if I'm in the placebo arm, and safety, and how do you follow up those patients?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I wouldn't have a patient with glaucoma on a placebo arm, and this hasn't been done in the United States except in the ocular hypertension treatment study, which was completed in 2002. And at the end of the completion of the study at that time, everybody was offered medical therapy. So the two placebo-controlled clinical trials that have been done in glaucoma that are big and important were both done in Europe and were both completed a long time ago. I think we're done with placebo compared to pressure lowering. So, you know, if you want to ask the question, is pressure lowering a benefit, you don't need a placebo. I mean, that question has been answered over and over and over now. We're done with that. But on the other hand, what if we have a new potentially neuroprotective drug? You know, let's say I mentioned resveratrol because I have an interest in resveratrol and it's something we could think about. We would have to do a placebo-controlled clinical trial with resveratrol, but everybody would get pressure-lowering therapy. So since we know pressure-lowering therapy is important in glaucoma, I think it would be unethical to do a clinical trial in which we did not offer pressure-lowering to everybody. So the question would be, if you have, let's say, glaucoma that developed with normal eye pressure, normal tension glaucoma, and the disease is getting worse despite medical therapy, and now we want to ask the question, does resveratrol or any other neuroprotective strategy work? I think it would be very reasonable to have a control group there, which was a placebo group. And that's because we just don't know. Does resveratrol help or not? It may not work at all. It may even hurt. And the only way to know is by having a good control group. And a placebo group is usually the best.
That's a great, great answer. Thank you for that. Madhu, you mentioned a lot of great studies being done, GRF and Catalyst and others, not just from pressure reduction studies, but now we're seeing a lot more data and a lot more, emphasis on non-pressure, kind of nerve regeneration, nerve stability, neuroprotection. Are there studies that you're excited about, let's say with using insulin or let's say, you know, even to say neuroprotection? And gene therapy. Anything you want to comment on those studies that are out there?
Yeah, I think one of the questions was asking about insulin, and it's been shown in the basic science world that insulin has been shown to stimulate dendritic growth. So basically, you know, growing these axons of the optic nerve, and so there are ongoing trial now. So we don't have the answer to that about insulin eye drops, because we know that insulin promotes growth. So the thought is that, is this growth going to lead to growth of that nerve? So more regeneration of the nerve itself, too. So
yeah, that's exciting. There's studies looking at topical insulin right now at that as well, different concentrations to see, because it does cross into the back of the eye, into the brain. So we can see that there's potential there. We'll have to wait and see what the studies show, but that is kind of interesting as well. What about gene?
I'm more excited about nicotinamide.
Sure, let's talk about that. Go ahead.
Yeah, and also metformin. So metformin is an FDA-approved drug for diabetes. And, you know, it's been shown now in a way that's fairly convincing from some population-based studies that people with diabetes who are on metformin are less likely to develop glaucoma than those who are not on metformin, looking at diabetic patients in both groups. I think that's fascinating, and the protection is pretty dramatic. And there are reasons to think that metformin might work, because metformin has an effect on mitochondria, which drive energetics in the eye, in the cells in the eye, like the ganglion cells. And the amount of energy activity that goes on in the cells in the eye is just amazing. It takes a lot of power to run the neural network that is in each of our eyes. And then nicotinamide is a vitamin that's been studied by a group in New York that includes Gus Demores, who's a really brilliant young scientist and clinician. And what they did was a randomized clinical trial crossover looking at the effect of nicotinamide, a fairly high dose, in the visual field. And what they saw was improvement in the visual field after a very short period of time on nicotinamide, and they've used the term neuroenhancement. It requires a bigger clinical trial for confirmation because there were some problems with the way the clinical trial was run. It happened during the COVID pandemic, so there were some technical issues there, but I think that it holds some promise and definitely deserves our attention.
Absolutely. There's a lot of research even in gene therapy and injecting into the vitreous and seeing if that can change kind of how we express certain genes in the eye. And so there's a lot going on in research. Some of them are early stages, phase one trials and even preclinical trials. But there's a lot of work being done on non-pressure related ways of protecting the nerve from getting worse. The question is that came up here, thought was interesting from one of our audience members, was how do we disseminate this information to patients so they can get involved with trials or how they can find out where trials are. Any thoughts, either one of you, of how to get this the word out to our patients on what's out there?
Yeah, I mean, I think that if I could just start with that, is that basically, you know, as much of this information, it's again this collaborative approach, trying to really get the clinicians to have an understanding too, and that's what these conferences are for. This is what all our education is for too. So as glaucoma specialists, I think we're unique in the field of ophthalmology in terms of we know that there's no real cure for things. We're not removing a cataract and that's it. And so we're always looking for new innovative ways of doing things. But again, we're dependent on the information from the basic science world as well too. And again, a lot of this information, like for the GRF, is, you know, publicly, you know, available, so you can get that research yourself too, and you can ask your clinician, hey, what about this? And maybe if we don't know, we can kind of look more into it as well too. So I'd encourage everyone to take really an active role. I mean, your doctors are doing their best, but research is changing so much that I think it really has to be, you know, really from all sides there too.
That's a great point. And I would just say, I've had patients come to me with articles all the time. They'll say, hey doc, I saw this article, I did some of my own research, what do you think of it? Sometimes I'll have to go look it up. So, you know, as much as we try to keep abreast of what's happening out there in the research world, but being in clinical practice, sometimes it's hard. So it's great to have patients who are coming to us with articles and questions that we have, that kind of keeps us on par as well. Any thoughts on that, Angela?
Well, for searching for clinical trials, there is a website called clinicaltrials.gov that's run by the federal government, and it, you know, in the U.S., if you do a clinical trial, you have to register your clinical trial on clinicaltrials.gov. So that's one way you could kind of search keywords and look and see what people in your area are doing. And I think it could be interesting, too. Absolutely. Educational.
Absolutely. Another question I had here. Are you guys familiar here with microcurrents therapy? Anyways, I'm curious on that, whereas external microcurrents kind of regenerating nerve cells and kind of helping blood flow. Any thoughts on that? Anyone know any information on that so far? The question came in.
I remain skeptical.
Okay. Yeah, so there's a lot of research on kind of external kind of stimulation of brain tissue to help regenerate nerves. Some equivocal meaning some positive and negatives right now. But again, there's so much more to talk about in terms of research. Definitely come up to us afterwards. We can go through that. And last question here, I think, is just real quick. Who's a good candidate for a study? I mean, how do you know if you're a good candidate? Do you have to ask your primary care doctor, your eye care doctor, or anything? Any comments on who's a good candidate for a study?
I think it depends on the study. You know, it's impossible to question, I think, to answer unless you know the specifics of the study. If you're being randomly assigned to one surgery or another, you may feel differently about it compared to being randomly assigned to one medication or another. And that medication, maybe they're both FDA approved. So I ran a clinical trial in which we looked at two different drugs that were already FDA approved. And you know, I think that that's easier to do from a, you know, personal safety, comfort kind of perspective from the patient standpoint compared to trying out a new surgery that no one has ever done before. So I think it depends on the person and the degree to which you're willing to accept risk, because some studies, you know, do come along with some risk.
And I would also say it depends on severity. Every study has a different kind of, what we call protocols to it, and what we call population. And so some are for early patients, maybe new patients, early glaucoma. Some are more for advanced glaucoma patients. So depending on the severity of the disease, depending on what type of surgery, if it's a drop or not, you may fall in those categories. So sometimes you may be a candidate or not, but I think it gets talk to your eye care provider, and that person, that doctor, can help you kind of guide you. If they don't know, they can also do some research for you to help you out as well. And I know we have, for the sake of time, we have to go. It's 12:05 here. Any other comments from Madhu about research for the audience?
No, I just like to summarize just by saying, you know, stay active and stay interested. Like Dr. Tanna was referring, that clinicaltrials.gov is a great website that we all use as well too. And just keep asking questions, because the research is just phenomenally just increasing. And again, what we think we don't know now, 20 years from now, we're gonna say, oh yeah, we've known that forever. So it's really rapidly changing. So just stay active, and it's very encouraging to see, you know, the amount of research that's being done to get into clinical trials as well too.
Well, I appreciate that. Yeah. So I think to rephrase the question, how do we disseminate this information to those maybe who don't, let's say, speak English or don't have the access to some of the information online or other avenues? Any thoughts on that, guys?
That is a terrific question. So the Glaucoma Research Foundation makes a book about glaucoma. It's a great book that explains glaucoma at a basic level that should be accessible to most people. And it's available in Spanish, directly from the Glaucoma Research Foundation. And that's a great service, by the way. So we actually recently did a study, we just published the study, in which we looked at the readability of website-based educational information about glaucoma. And what we found was that the average reading level was around 12th grade. And the recommendation from the AMA is to keep it at the 6th to 8th grade reading level to make it accessible to people. So there are some people, you know, and I think most, if not every one of you in this room, you know, you're people, I could give you an article I wrote for other doctors and you'd be able to read it and understand it. But there are many people out there for whom that is not the case. And in fact, so we created educational material. When we discovered this, that most of the material out there was inaccessible, in fact, all of it was inaccessible based on what was available on the web, we created our own material that was designed to be educational about glaucoma and made it at the 8th grade reading level. It's hard to do, you know, when you have to use some technical terminology like trabecular meshwork, you know, it automatically triggers the reading level and makes it so it's hard to get under that 6th to 8th grade level. So you're absolutely right. This is a very important problem, and that's what we've done to try to help. And that material is publicly available on the Northwestern Medicine website.
And it goes to your point about just even access to healthcare. Access to a certain population of patients out there who don't even have access, which we really have to get better at. So there's definitely communities around the country in different areas of the country, different ethnic backgrounds that aren't gaining the access to this, not just the information, but even the care itself. And there's a lot more work we have to do. In our practice, we do create, again, our own pamphlets, our own information for research, so that when patients come in, they have a basic understanding of what's potentially out there. But I think we do have more work to do. That's a good point, absolutely.
Yeah, I think I would second all those comments, but also I think the first really great change for us, it was the internet, you know, because information wasn't just available by if you had a good library near you or if you had a great clinician, if you weren't fortunate enough to have those things. And so that really made information available, but then the next level is an information that we can be able to reach out to patients, and we're not there yet. We've kind of just gone over that first hump. So.